Thank you for this introduction. I think from now on it can only go downhill after such an introduction. So it's a pleasure to be here. So thank you for your attention, and I would like to spend a bit of time on AI and also the implications on work. Before doing so, I have a few topics which I'm keen to cover. And first of all, as a true consultant, you will see some nice pictures and those kind of things. But I have the following flow, actually, for the coming 30 minutes or so in mind. First of all, I would like to briefly touch base on, very briefly, on the introduction side, Capgemini and Capgemini Invent. But then also move more into the space of, okay, what are trends do we see actually in the market, and what is actually the common denominator impacting also work? Then I'm keen to explain a bit about Fathom. That is a collaboration we have with an Australian research company. And they basically do a lot of research on the implication or the impact of technology on work. And I'm keen to share some of these findings they have, but also what it actually entails for the different functions in an organization, what it means for recruitment, but also what it actually means for where to focus on if you would like to automate using AI concepts. And that is also the last part when we talk about, okay, what are the new roles, what roles will actually go out of business, what roles will actually change or adapt. So that's more or less the structure for the coming for the coming half hour, 45 minutes. A bit about myself. So Mark Berger from Capgemini, 7 years with Capgemini, before that a long time with Deloitte, also lecturing at the University of Amsterdam in the field of organizational development, PhD in the UK on business administration. So that's a bit of my background. Moved actually into more the digital space because I thought if you talk about business transformation, it cannot do without digital anymore. I mean, there is always a digital component. And if you look at the big corporate landscape in the Netherlands, but also beyond, there is with every major business transformation, there is a huge digital component to it. So I thought that's more the space where I'm keen to be in. So, and you now see that technology is actually driving the transformation. And of course, then looking into, okay, what does it actually mean for customers? What's the value it actually generates for employees, but also outside? I think that are really interesting questions nowadays. And the technology developments go increasingly fast, so lots of opportunities out there, I think, for everyone here in the room and outside. So interesting times. Now, to tell a bit about the company, Capgemini, that's around 200,000 employees. We recently acquired Altran. If you add that, it's around 250,000 employees. Big part of it is in India. We actually bought Altran also to get into the space of intelligent industry, because we see that IT and OT, if you actually combine that, so actually put more intelligence into, for example, supply chain, procurement, and those kind of things, there's a big win which can actually be made. Now, if you look at Capgemini, it's a big organization where you actually have consulting, where you have development of all kinds of applications, you have run and maintain, and of course, we also insource services. Capgemini has invested significantly in the front part, in the digital space. And I think important to mention here is that the digital space, the consulting space around that, that's called Capgemini Invent. And basically what we do is looking for the potential of digital for business. And that's never pushing a product, but it is always look at, okay, what kind of value can we create? And that's always bespoke to clients. And we help clients in transforming to get to that value proposition. So what we do, and we have a few, let's say, families residing within Capgemini Invent. We have, let's say, more traditional strategy and transformation expertise, but we combine it with innovation, we combine it with creativity, and also with data. That's actually the main families within Capgemini Invent. In the Netherlands, 330 people, global around 8,000 people, doing more or less around a billion of revenue. So that's a bit about the company. Now, Let me focus on the trends we actually see in the market, but also what the common denominator is. Because there's a lot, of course, already said about digital, and then, of course, it's not only digital, but then they say, oh, what's it on cloud, what's AI and the impact on social, the whole automation part, etc. So there are many of these words that are actually coming. And if you talk about data management or insights and data, I think it's those words that are used so often, because if you talk about data and insights, yeah, for some it's not an insight, but it's obvious, and for the other it's a real door opener. So AI and insights is definitely a concept which is, let's say, it's also a buzzword, and there is so many meanings attached to it that I'm keen to provide a little bit of direction on some of these concepts. But what we see as the major trends, and just take out a few. So for example, the customer centricity. If you look at business nowadays, optimizing the customer experience is pivotal. It's not only the external customer, but it is also the internal customer. And basically you see, for example, shared service centers now moving much more into the domain of a capability development center, and making sure that you not only, let's say, optimize your services as a shared service center, but you also come with new ideas, with new services, and you actually go beyond the traditional shared service centers. And with that, you actually link to the customer experience, but then internally, and then it becomes an employee experience, liaising directly with the business. So that are some of these developments, that customer centricity, not only in, externally, but also internally. I think the new business models, definitely an important one we see. So telcos become banks at the moment, and you see that there is quite a blur between different markets. And with that, the competition landscape is changing dramatically. And for example, if I'm being part of the consulting business, we carefully look, for example, at Amazon.com, and when Amazon is actually or Google hitting the consulting market and come with big data and a lot of analytics and actually advising clients on where to invest, how to invest, etc. So you see that competitors, which were not seen as competitors a few years ago, all of a sudden entering the market. I think that the third one, the end of stupidity, that's another one. So we have so much data. Will we have, let's say, AI in the boardroom? Question mark. And how about human judgment? And these are trends out there. And basically, you see the numbers actually reflecting on the different trends I just showed. It's already ongoing. So if you talk about the customer experience, It's me now here already, because it's if you look at some of the big trends about products moving into services and actually resulting into experience. And that experience is always individual based on a lot of data. And to have the speed and increase the service concept around it, I think that's where the market is going towards. The one experience, so for example, buying a product with one mouse click, because it is already fully tailored on the particular needs of the buyer, and there's a lot of intelligence, of course, behind in order to make it to analyze that and present that only to that particular client, but also the new business model, premium quality, a lot of data behind, and all of a sudden new enters of the market actually come with interesting business concepts. So you see a lot of these trends already taking place, and that's already quite in rapid development. Now let me give a few examples on what's out there in the market. I picked a few industries and take out some of the relevant examples. So for example, if you talk about the technology development and how that is shaping in the financial sector, I think an interesting one, for example, is the PSD2. I'm not sure if you heard about it, but it's a big thing. Then it starts in the Scandinavian world, and then the regulators are saying, well, banks, you need to be careful. You need to put the customer first, not the transaction. And if there's legislation around it, then actually telcos can become banks because the customer is put central. And what you now see is that from the Nordics, it actually moved down to more Western Europe. So we have doing some big work at some of the banks around this particular topic. But it is actually quite a game changer for the banks because all of a sudden, they're not, let's say, the prime player in the banking anymore. There are other companies, other competitors who also can provide banking services, because all of a sudden the customer is central rather than the transaction of the payment service. And of course, for banks, it's pivotal then to look at, okay, what kind of services am I actually going to provide to my customers, and what are the new product market combinations I can actually make? So you see that the banks are really reshaping their future, coming up with new products and services. Now, also, for example, the finance on demand. So whatever the channel you use, that you can actually have the optimized banking experience you desire. And so you see a lot of banks moving into the field of also the customer experience part. And despite the different channels you use, you always have your tailored and best experience the bank can actually offer. Now, some other examples, I think, in retail. The one I would like to cover here is the last mile. That's more like a supply chain topic, and a lot of retailers are actually looking into it. So, for example, if you want to order some goods, some products, and deliver it at home, of course, if you are the sending party, you would want to deliver quality, you want to bring it with speed, and at the same time, it needs to be efficient. But customers are willing to pay a premium that if you order something now, it will be delivered in 2 hours' time. And you see these concepts of the last mile delivery are picking up. And in the Netherlands, we're on our way. But if you go to the US and you want to order a book, and there are so many of these transportations going on, you have it in 1 or 2 hours, it's already delivered at your office. So you see that those kind of delivery concepts are rapidly changing. And for a premium price, you can actually, companies can earn a good bit of money while there is a more optimal service experience by the customer. And I think the AI-driven experience, I think that's also an interesting concept where actually based on data, based on all the analysis that's done, that you proactively get all kinds of products advice to you via the channels you actually use. Now, consumer products, I think we are working at the moment with a large company who's selling furniture, and we're now with blue and with yellow, I will not mention the name. We're also looking at service concepts, that it's not only selling the furniture, but it is also, can you actually subscribe on getting new furniture every 2 or 3 years? And with that, you have augmented reality. You need to know the customer, what are the preferences, what is the developments in terms of the choice the individual has, are there any kids, are there any pets, etc. So you need to know a lot of information about the customer, but all of a sudden you think about a new business model, which is basically subscribe on IKEA and then get advice on what furniture to buy in the next few months. So that are new business models. I think another interesting example, and that is also changing the landscape dramatically. So for example, the concept of personalized medicine. So for example, if you now buy vitamin pills, you can buy them 20 or 40 milligram. I was working with a vitamin manufacturer, said, yeah, this is the market, with the small pills and the big pills. And well, if you're not feeling well, you take the big pill. But all of a sudden, the market is changing, and through technology developments, what happens actually is that you go to the pharmacy, you hand in a drop of blood, it will be tested on a few characteristics, and out of that comes okay, you need to have the 33 milligram from this particular vitamin. And by the way, if you click okay, it will be sent to your home in the next 2 or 3 days and with the bill, etc. So all of a sudden, the pill manufacturers, they need to collaborate with pharmacia, they need to work with the medical experts, but they also need to work with device companies, because handing in the drop of blood is of course a different type of service they're not in yet. But what also happens is that they need to rearrange their supply chain, because their whole supply chain was geared towards 20 or 40 milligrams. So they go from a product from 20, 40 milligrams to providing a service, medical advice on you need the 33, to an experience by bringing the whole medicine back to your home. So these kind of developments are all taking place at the moment. And I think that is making it interesting, because all of a sudden the big companies who have an inability to change, of course, will lag behind. And organizations which are a bit more nimble or can change more rapidly, they actually take the market. I think the automotive, the last industry I would like to cover. So for example, car sharing is coming up, and especially of course in the big cities, it's already a famous concept. The interesting thing is that the data you actually build up around the driver is actually linked to the person driving it rather than to the vehicle. So you need to build up a whole new intelligence around the driver, which is not specifically related to the car. So these type of changes actually also has a big impact on the car manufacturer, because all of a sudden they need to think about mobility rather than pushing out cars. And that mobility concept that actually generates new models to generate business. Now, a few examples. So just to illustrate that a lot is happening out there, and it's going with a significant pace. And it's, to be honest, all at once in all the industries. Now, normally, and I think the light blue curve actually shows that, that if a technology comes in, you have a kind of the bell curve where there are some innovators and it takes a lot of time, and then you have some early adopters and the late majority, and then you have the whole bulk in, and of course you still have people who are lagging behind, who will never adopt technology. But what you see with all these changes in technology, that adoption curve is actually significantly changed. So you see it actually peaking very fast, but what is also happening that it actually drops down also dramatically after a bit of time. And that repetition is going faster and faster with the upcoming upcoming technologies. Now, just to give you an example, so for example, WhatsApp, it's the example of a few years old, but if you look at the how fast the penetration was of WhatsApp, it was tremendous. They did a Facebook campaign, they had some other campaigns, and they went from 0 to 900 million users per year in 1 year. And what you see is that the new technology, the new concepts, the new service concepts, they become very easy and they become very cheap. And that is actually what is causing that the pace of change is actually increasing. Now, you know these type of curves, eh? That is, yeah, it's a kind of a hockey stick, and it was slow, and we are here at where it actually bends, and then whatever comes is really, really cheap, steep. So, but to be honest, and of course that's where the difficulty is, if you're in that curve and you're here today, you actually don't know what's beyond it. So in order to prepare for new jobs, to prepare for what type of people do you need to recruit, how do you set up your learning and development curriculum to make sure that people are trained with the right skills, etc., it's very difficult to predict. Because we can't predict the future, well, let me go here, and we don't know what's behind the line. And of course, there's a lot of predictions on work and how technology is actually impacting work. And now I come to the research of Fathom. And what Fathom actually did is they looked into roles, and they looked at different countries, different companies, and with that they categorized it into different market segments. but they also looked into different functions within the company, HR, finance, and what have you. And what you see here is that the bigger the bulb, the bigger the impact is on work. And they looked at a wide variety of research. And so what you see is that the impact of work, and you see, and by the way, this is quite negative, because what is yellow or different shades of yellow is actually job destroying jobs, and the gray ones is actually creating the jobs. So you see little gray jobs bulbs here, but a lot of jobs destroyed. But what you do see is that from all the research types they did, all the research actually indicate it will have a major impact on jobs, the whole technology development. Now, I think that's a bit of an open door, but at the same time, when you bring that down to day-to-day reality, I think it's interesting to explore it a bit more. Because if you look, for example, autonomous driving, and it's already partly there, but that driver, of course, and especially if there are big highways, then of course the driver for a long time is not sitting behind the wheel, or he or she can, but nothing to do. But what will he or she do in the meantime? So that driver, because normally he was driving, but all of a sudden through autonomous driving, he has time left. Of course, you could say, well, he could call up clients, do some service support, and provide some care of good customers or what have you. But the average truck driver, he needs a bit of reskilling to be the great service provider and customer care person of the company. So that perhaps requires a bit of reskilling. But this is already taking place. The other one, and I think this is also taking place, especially in the Middle East, between different skyscrapers, you have these drones, which actually carry people, and they actually fly from one skyscraper to the other. Where are the taxi drivers here? So that's another, let's say, role that is going to be less and less in our field of occupations. Another one, I think, is the train driver, of course, with and this is already taking place, of course. The train driver now only has to push a button every so many seconds, and if he doesn't, then the train stops, but if he does, it's great. But that will be automated further and further. So there again, you see that jobs are destroyed. I think we all know this example. The cashier is not needed anymore. You just log in, you walk with the product outside, and automatically it's actually deducted from your bank account. So another type of job which will be heavily impacted by technology. So, and I think, of course, we all have those when you have, let's say, the car from your the window from your car is actually damaged, and you are going to send a WhatsApp to your insurance company. You actually do the WhatsApp with a bot rather than with a person. And that, of course, 70% of what is happening now in the customer care is through bots. So again, a huge population of people, a huge occupation is actually heavily hit by the rise of technology. Now, of course, that raises the question, is this all bad? Because all these jobs destruction is actually awful. And I'm calling that the Frankenstein factor, because we have created something like Frankenstein was created with the best intention, because it was a new evolvement of man. But in the end, it appeared to be a monster. So Frankenstein factor, question mark. To be honest, I'm quite optimistic, because if you look at the impact of technology, it actually frees us up from routine work, boring work, dangerous work, etc. And it actually freeing up time for more creative work, spending more time on other occupations. The only thing is that we have a lot of work actually established in AI. So there's a lot of it is actually automated. So what kind of values are actually established in that AI? So I used to work for a small company called Tromp & House Hamden & Turner, and we talked about values. But the whole ethical part of digital becomes increasingly important. There we said, the small company, it's about values to behavior. And you need to have a kind of a compass that if you talk about respect and integrity, how does it demonstrate itself into behavior? But here, we actually need to talk about, okay, how is AI actually impacting the values you as a company are actually standing for? And these values are becoming increasingly important. And testing, let's say, what you do internally with your employees, but also towards the clients, needs to be much more rigorously tested against the value framework you have. And that's one element. The second element is the risk you have as a company. So, for example, looking at the data, you can actually personalize, for example, insurance policies quite easily. But and that has to do with not only making, let's say, products digital, but also new digital products. You go to Germany, and you get a pop-up on your phone, and it's saying, hey, we see you're in Germany. By the way, you don't have coverage in Germany, but if you click here, you have your insurance extended to Germany. By the way, it's winter, so you need to have winter tires, etc. So the insurance companies move into that type of service offerings. At the same time, personalized products means that you differentiate also in terms of pricing. The risk they run is they say, that person is from a type of age, perhaps a kind of ethnicity, has a bigger risk factor, so we need to ask a bigger price. And all of a sudden, as a company, you run the risk that, is this what we want? Because all of a sudden, we have, let's say, we can expect perhaps claims, or we have we come in a shady world that some clients pay a lot more than other clients. So that type of discussions are becoming increasingly important. And actually, they need to precede all the AI work that is actually pushed forward now. Now, to give a bit of more impact on, of a more explanation on the impact on work, what Fathom actually did was actually looking at these type of technology developments. So it was social AI, it was the process AI, it was the mobile robotics, fixed robotics, which actually were already there. I think in the 70s, 80s, where the assembling of cars were actually already done by robotics, but of course advanced significantly, but also technology into materials. So these five types of technology was actually looked into. And what we see is that, and I think this is an important slide, that if you look at AI and where AI can make an impact on work, it actually started on the right bottom. So it was on checkout, retail, distribution centers, pickers, packers, those kind of things. So it was routine work, manual work, and it was actually very labor intensive. Now it's actually through automation, RPA, it's actually moving up to the right corner above. It's about data entry, it's about the customer care, just shown in the example, routine accounting, what have you. And that type of work is actually going to be automated. It's already in full blown, but what you do see is that there is a shift left, and that is becoming increasingly important. So all the non-routine work, so for example, the architect, the doctors, where there's a kind of art or there's a kind of creativity required, that type of jobs are becoming increasingly important. Also, the manual type of work, which is non-routine, like the hairdresser, you don't want to have your hair cut by a robot. Well, perhaps in my instance, it wouldn't make a lot of difference, but for most people, it's actually quite a creative type. And also the barista, of course, I was looking at the queues, but the barista got a lot of more demand on preparing the coffee than the machines you could actually use yourself. So also there you see on the manual side, non-routine side, there will be a big demand. And it's already there. So if you ask for, I live in Friesland, and if I am calling for a plumber, I can wait another 6 weeks or something like that. So all these type of manual work, there's a big demand on it. So that's an interesting development. Now, if we look at the research, actually we see four type of changes. And that is, you see three types here, but there's another one. So jobs that will be automated, jobs that will be augmented, and the addition. So jobs will fully disappear. There will be some jobs that that will be changed, also jobs that will be unchanged, but there will also be new jobs. And I think this is an interesting... one slide. So jobs from the future, and jobs that did not exist about 10 years ago. And of course, we had jobs like, for example, the app developer. Of course, that doesn't sound very sexy. But for example, now all of a sudden, you, if you look up on the internet, you have a drone pilot, for example. That sounds quite fancy. That did not exist 10 years ago. So we have jobs that are new. In addition to that, you see that influencers as a new type of job. So you see that despite the fact that there are jobs will disappear, other jobs will actually come. Now, and I think it's important to, let me jump here also in view of time and then go back also one slide, that if you look at the at these jobs and also to prepare for the future, some jobs of the web analyst, the online influencer, the sustainability director, the drone pilot. I think for the people to prepare, and that's also for you within companies, skills that are becoming increasingly important, it's much more about the interpersonal skills or the digital and technology savviness. So if you, for example, now working in a shared service center, it's not about you managing other people, but it is you managing an ecosystem of all kinds of different data sources. That's the landscape. So you need to have advanced digital and technology skills. The analytical skills in combination with the social skills, that's also becoming increasingly important. New entrepreneurship, so you see that new product market combinations are increasing. So looking for opportunities in the market and how you can actually generate value, that becomes a much more creative process. So that type of entrepreneurship, that's an asset within a firm. So that companies will have a big, let's say, routine part in the culture. It's a big challenge for them to foster that particular part. So innovation, new entrepreneurship are becoming skills for the future. Also the continuous learning. So how do you actually develop a workforce that is not, let's say, sticking to a particular role, but you actually work as a company on your teaching proposition? So what do you have to offer to accelerate the learnings of your employee? So that should become part of the employee branding of a company. So you have these kind of concepts that are becoming increasingly important for companies. Now, to go one back, and I think that is going back to the research as well, that if you look at the, let's say, some of the choices company have, for example, where would we like to have, let's say, our new plants? Is it in China? Perhaps not the best alternative right now. But if it is another place rather than the Netherlands, are there the right skills? And actually, you have some research from FATM actually looking into that particular pocket if the right skills are available. For example, if you want to bring in a technology into a firm, what's the technology that has the biggest impact on the quality of work and also the efficiency gains you can actually have? Also preparing employees for change in terms of learning and development, etc. So the implication of AI needs to thought through. That's the essence of this slide. Research actually needs to be done to see, okay, what technologies are we going to invest and where actually will be the biggest impact of the money you you invest, because a broad brush, and that's basically the challenge we see now in companies, there are many proof of concepts, there's many innovation going on, but the scale-up is the challenge. How to make it broad brush and make sure that there is, let's say, a bigger gain for the primary processes and for the bigger group in the organization. And I think this particular research, and I'm not talking specifically about FATM, but that you, in your role in professional life, but perhaps also at university, think through about, okay, where's the biggest bang for the buck? Where's the biggest impact I can make? Because applying all the concepts into once will lead into chaos. So that requires a bit of thinking. So let me end with this particular slide. I think AI, I think the technology advancements, that will have a major impact. And it's also an unstoppable impact. We need to think through how to do that in a way that we take people along, that it fits to our ethical standards. And I think this having in mind, technology destroys jobs, but not occupations. So let me stop here for a second. I'm not sure if it is time. It's time. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Perhaps some questions.